Wigs 101. Thank you all for getting up this early and with all the packing up and everything and coming. My name is Melinda. I work for Arta Wigs, and this is my husband Kyle. He also works for Arta Wigs. I am their customer support and their stylist. So, like, if you see any of their video tutorials and things like that on how to style wigs, or you come and emailed customers at Arta Wig and be like, what style and color do you recommend for this character? I was probably the one that helped you out. So, without further ado, we are going to go ahead and start.
And don't leave without grabbing a business card that has a code for 5% off on a wig purchase.
Next Arta 2 weeks, yeah. This panel is going to cover a lot of, the beginner stuff. Like, you know, what kind of wigs should you use for different kinds of costume, you know, like the different types of wigs available and things like that. I do go into some basic styling in this panel, but I do also have an advanced wig panel at 12:30, and it's going to cover a lot of really cool techniques and things like that. So be sure to check that out. I can probably talk about some of those things if you guys have questions at the end, but I don't know how much time there's going to be. So, but if you have any questions during the panel, just feel free to raise your hand, and hopefully we'll get all through those. So the wig anatomy. If you look, turn a wig inside out, you're going to notice that there is rows upon rows of what we call wefts, and that's basically hair that's been like sewn at the top. The hair is first sewn usually down like the middle or a couple inches from the ends, and then the factory will fold that over and then they'll sew it again at the top, so it's got this nice clean edge. And you know, they just basically do rows. You can kind of tell a good quality wig from a bad quality one based on the amount of wefts that it has. Typically, if you go like to Party City and grab one of those wigs, the wefts are going to be like an inch apart, and it's going to be really thin. You know, it's more likely that you're going to see that the lace and stuff underneath it. So, like, you know, when you're looking at on eBay and things like that, and you're kind of looking for, you see like a $20 wig, it's probably not going to be, it's not going to be like necessarily like a Party City wig, but it may be a little thinner than a $30 wig, things like that. So you're really getting what you pay for in that sense. So those are what the wefts are, and you can also buy, sometimes you can get wefts separately, whether it be from Arta or from your local beauty supply store. They'll sell like extensions. Sometimes they'll already have clips on them, you just clip them in your own hair. Sometimes they'll just be, you know, loose, like the picture on the left, where they may be like tied at the top, but you just untie it and then it is like a huge strand. But those are, you know, you can buy the, people buy those to thicken their wig, or they might want to add color, extra colors to their wig. Or they might just use it for other styling purposes. There's all kinds of things you can do with them. So that is what else. All right, so when you're selecting a wig for your costume, typically, at Arta, we have two types of fibers. And that can really impact, you know, what you're looking for when it comes to getting a wig. Some people just want something that's just easy to take care of, that they can just put on their head. It's a little easier to comb, things like that. Whereas other people might just want something that's easier to style. The Arta carries two types of fibers. One's called the Classic, and that's the fiber we've been carrying since, you know, the company was brand new. It's the fiber's got a more matte kind of texture to it, so it looks really good in photos. People really like that quality. They do have more of a texture to it though. Like it's not that it's like really rough or anything, but it's not as like super smooth as maybe some eBay wigs you might find or something. And I mean, the benefit of that is that it's great for styling. Like, if you're trying to spike a wig, that's the kind of wig you want to get, because the hairspray will stick a little better and it's just easier to do those kinds of things. But then at the same time though, some people don't like that fiber type because it's more likely to tangle. Like, no matter what, long hair is going to tangle. Human hair will tangle. It's just the fact of life. So, but with the Classic fibers, they're a little harder to untangle compared to like our silky fibers, and so some people prefer the silky fibers because of that ease that it has. However, the downside of silky fibers is that it is a bit shinier, and it doesn't take hairspray as well. So like, if you're trying to style something like spikes and stuff like that, they're more likely to split apart or not stick as well. But we're actually coming out with an upgraded version of the fiber in July. I think we're getting a restock of it. I know there's a lot of people who've been asking us questions on when are silky going to get restocked, and our company actually made a factory visit back in March, and they talked and discussed all these different kinds of things, and we figured, like, we've improved the fiber, so it's actually going to be less shiny, and it's still going to be soft. So hopefully you guys will enjoy that when we come out with it, but that'll be later this summer. Besides fiber types, some different things you're going to want to look at when it comes to wigs is the type of top it has, how the wig is made. And there's different, and I'm going to go into each slide with different kinds of qualities that these wigs have. So without further ado, types of wigs. So the most common type of wig you're probably going to find is one that has what we call a skin coin. There's like maybe a little quarter-sized piece of plastic that's near the crown of the wig where the fibers are like hand-punched into it, and then they're kind of ironed to fan outwards. And so it kind of looks like it's a fake piece of skin there, but it's just plastic that the fibers hand-punched into. And then the wefts are spiraled around that spot. And this is a really easy wig to make. They're not too expensive or anything. They'll have like a specialty price added onto it. But if you were to like part the hair down the center, like in the left image, especially on like really light colored wigs, you're gonna see the wefts showing because there's not that skin top coming all the way forward, or there's not this as much teasing going on, which we'll show you in the next few slides. But it's not too bad of a fix. You just have to comb the hair forward and then just part it at the very front. So that picture on the right is actually the same wig, it's just been combed differently. So that's something to, you know, if you just want a wig that is just, you put it on, part the bangs, you know, you're done, you can just do that. If you're trying to get a wig that has like a defined part where you do like see skin showing, like say this, you're doing a specific character that has that kind of, you know, hairstyle, or they have like a zigzag part or something, then you might want to get a different kind of wig, which we'll go into in just a sec. So that's this one. This is a larger skin top wig, and typically these cost a bit more to make because there's more hand punching of the fibers, it just takes more time, so therefore they're a little pricier. But there are wigs that have that kind of, like that plastic piece, but it covers entire front portion of the wig. And that allows you to part it however you want, you can do zigzag parts and things like that.
Bless you.
Right, so, but usually you have to use like, you use a hair dryer to kind of iron that part in place. Sometimes the factory will already have the hair ironed a certain way, but you can just use heat from a hairdryer to kind of undo that and make it go wherever you want. But yeah, so that's those kinds of wigs. And then another type of wig that's really common is the pre-tease top. And these wigs don't have a skin piece at all. They're just, but if you look up close, the fibers will be kind of frizzy at the roots. And that's actually a very common method. It's cheap to make those kinds of wigs. And some people don't like that frizzy quality, but it's actually super handy when you're doing things like spiky wigs. And it's also got like it kind of creates a bit more coverage. So if you want to part the hair on the side or things like that, it's a bit easier to do without the wefts showing. So you can kind of have that part without paying for the price of a full skin top wig. It doesn't look the same, but it's like, you know, the cheap alternative. And it's also got more volume to it. Any questions before I keep going? Okay.
Oh.
Yes, I can see you.
Are you going to talk anything about like wigs for like Lolita and other fashions, or is it just mostly cosplay?
I mean, I can. I mean, our wigs are, like, we have a lot of cosplay customers, but we cater our wigs to everybody. I actually do Lolita myself, and I love using our wigs for Lolita. And if you want recommendations for certain styles, I can always get those to you when we get to the end of the panel.
Okay.
All right, so another type of wig that is becoming increasingly popular is lace fronts. And lace fronts have, it's kind of like it's similar to tulle, but it's not the same. If you know, like, this kind of meshy, more sort of lace material, it basically covers the front area of the wig, and then the fibers along maybe the first inch or two are tied with like a latch hook method. And this is a very time consuming process to do. And that's why these wigs tend to run pretty pricey, but it gives the most natural hairline appearance. It kind of looks like it's coming out of your own forehead. And so a lot of people will like these wigs for like if you're doing a slicked back style or things like that. They're super popular, like they were really popular with Elsa. There's a ton of characters now that have that kind of slicked back look, and they, from Haikyuu. So like, you know, it is pricier, but it gives that more like, you know, people will probably mistake it for your real hair because it looks like it. Typically the lace that's in the front, there's excess amounts of it in case you want to alter the hairline to kind of make it, if you want to alter the hairline to kind of like, if you were doing like Axl from Kingdom Hearts and you want to have like his defined hairline with kind of more of like a zigzag look to it, you could do that ventilating method yourself to add more to it. And then once you're done, you can cut away that excess of the lace. Typically, a lot of people like to leave just a little bit, like maybe half an inch or so excess, so that when you apply it, because when you apply it, usually you will want to use either spirit gum or lace front tape, which is kind of like a really strong double-sided tape to keep it down so it won't like flip up. And keeping that little excess lace will help you get more coverage for that. But some people will just trim it all the way up, and that's fine too. And then there's, of course, other kinds of unique types of wigs out there. You can now get wigs for pigtails. That used to not be a thing until, you know, like, back in my day. But, you know, now you can get wigs that have that skin top piece, like the plastic piece that goes all the way down the back of the wig. And you can also get ponytail wigs. There's two pictures right there on the middle and the right. The middle one's actually a lace front, but what makes that wig really ponytail friendly is that it has the wefts in the back are sewn in reverse. Yes, is our Morpheus style. So instead of the hair, the wefts being sewn traditionally where the hair is going down, they're sewn so the hair actually would go up. And I mean, it falls down in the picture, but if you would want to style an updo or things like that, it's a little easier to work with. And there's also hair along the bottom edge in the back that's sewn along the underside, and then it's like ironed over. And that helps hide like the wig elastic that's along the back. So that's what makes ponytail wigs really good for ponytails. And the same with the right wig. That's actually a wig that has the weft sewn in reverse. It just isn't a lace front. And then it has actually a clip-on ponytail that goes on top of the base wig's ponytail. But like those wigs have those qualities. You can put a lot of artist wigs into ponytails, but you might run into a situation where that back edge is showing. It's not really as common with like darker colors, but like if you're putting a lighter color wig up, you might see that. So, but you know, you can easily alter wigs to make them ponytail friendly by just adding some wefts along that bottom edge and then like ironing them over. Just even like I usually do like three rows of wefts is enough. You don't have to make the wefts go in reverse. That's just, you know, if you want that, it's easier just to get the wig that's already made for that. So, you know, just some different things to think about. All right, so, you know, when it comes to styling, these are just a list of some things I usually have on hand for wigs. Hairspray is really good for styling. You don't want to use hair gels because they're kind of meant to react with the oils that human hair produces, and wigs aren't going to produce human hair oil. So you kind of have to use different kinds of styling products that are still going to stick even if it doesn't have the porosity and the oils that human hair has. So hairspray is just really good. I like to use Got to Be Glued hairspray. It comes in a yellow can. It's not good for your real hair, but it's great for wigs. And then a cheaper alternative is Aquanet. That has a pretty good stronghold too. It's not as strong as the Got to Be, but it's cheaper. You can also get Got to Be carries a glue that's called, this is like it's their hair glue. It comes in the same yellow kind of packaging, but it comes in a bottle, a squeeze bottle. And that's good for like the tips of spikes. Like I use that very sparingly because if you try to style an entire wig with it, it's probably going to get a little messy and kind of greasy looking. So I usually will use hairspray for most of it, and then like the glue is just like in like the tips of spikes to hold them together because sometimes they'll split over time. It just kind of gives that extra security. A wide tooth comb and a fine tooth comb are good for both care and styling. I've seen people destroy wigs with wig brushes. So if you're going to use a wig brush, just kind of know how to use it. I'll be kind of going into the care and untangling things like that. But typically, you want to start at the bottom and work your way up. And just having a wide tooth comb is enough. You don't necessarily need to have a specialized wig brush or anything like that. I don't really like the wig brushes. They're basically designed to be less harsh. Human hair brushes are designed to pull out like your dead hairs from your own head. They're going to be a little rough on a wig. So they design wig brushes to have more flexible bristles, so that way it's not going to pull as hard on them. But if people don't know how to start at the bottom and work their way up, I've seen people like really destroy their wigs. So just make sure you do that. Don't start at the top and work your way down, because that's just going to create a rat's nest at the bottom. Fine tooth comb though is good for styling. Like if you're doing, we'll be going into the spiking and stuff like that. It's good for like back combing and teasing. Cutting tools, you kind of want to have just a pair of shears. A $10 pair of shears from like Walmart or Sally's is fine. You don't need to have anything really fancy. But you kind of want to make sure that you keep them separate from your other crafting. Like don't use your hair shears on your paper. And also don't use your hair shears on your own hair. Like, you know, keep those separate. You can also get razor combs, which have a replaceable blade. And sometimes you can use those. They're really fun to use to get a cool, like, you know, feathered look when you're cutting hair. You might see stylists use them. But the blades will dull really fast, so you have to kind of get the type that has replaceable blades. And then you want to, that's if you want to invest in that. But I typically can do the same kind of effect with shears, and I'll kind of show you a visual of how you can do that. Various clips and pins, you can get like, they call them toupee clips, or sometimes they're called clips too. They have little teeth on them and they snap like snappy clips, but then those are great for putting on the inside hairline of your wig to kind of keep it from falling back if it's really back heavy, like those ponytail wigs. And they also, like, if you have a hard time with wigs just wanting to slip off, they're handy to have. You also kind of want various types of pins to secure the wig to your head. Or even when you're styling, I will show you how, like, you know, you kind of want to separate the hair out when you're styling. Because if you're styling that Sora wig, and you put all of this hair into these top spikes, and then you get to the bangs, you don't have enough hair in the bangs, you're like, oh no, I don't have enough hair left. So, like, I usually recommend when you're styling to have clips just to plan out the style first before you get to actually spiking the wig. A flat iron is good if you are using heat-resistant wigs and you want to curl them. And I'll be talking about how heat-resistant fibers work in a few slides. Hair rollers are good for curling. Mannequins, you can get like styrofoam wig heads like this one in this box. We have them for like $5 on the artist site. You can also get them at some craft stores. Styrofoam ones are pretty cheap. There's also canvas ones that are made for, they're in a larger size and they're really heavy. Typically a wig head is going to be smaller than a human head. So if you're styling a wig on a mannequin head, if you're using the styrofoam one, I usually recommend like measuring your own head and possibly padding it up a little bit, because otherwise it's going to be like you might style a wig and then it looks completely different on your own head than it does on the wig head. You can also get wig stands. Like there's a type of stand that you can get that latches onto a table, and it you just like, you know, tighten it around the table edge, and then it has like a pivot piece. Because when you look on the underside of a wig head, there's a hole, and you can put that on that pivot piece, and then like it'll let you tip it around, things like that while you style it. And you also just, you know, tighten it so it keeps it in place. There are other types of wig stands you can use, or you can even use household items. I actually use an old lamp that's just really tall that I put this wig head on, and so that way I can stand while I'm styling it and it's easy just to get around it and things like that. I know some people have used plungers, which you can just suction into the floor and then you got a stick. Yeah, there's all kinds of things people use for them. I've seen people use like those dust pans that are pretty level with the floor so they can step on it to hold it in place, and then it's a tall enough stand that they can stand while they work on it. All kinds of things you can engineer for that. Wetting supplies, I told you, you can get wefts online, but you can get like special wefting needles. They're just typically a thick needle, and there's also wefting thread, which is just a sturdy thread that they use to make the wigs. But honestly, you can use regular sewing needles and thread as well. I like to use the Gooderman thread because it's really strong and also comes in a lot of colors. So like, you know, you can use it just about any of that stuff you use for sewing as well. Lace front supplies. So like I told you, you know, you can do extra ventilating into the wig to create special hairlines. It's basically you can get this metal needle holder is what it's called. It's just like a little metal stick piece that has, and then it has like the little needle on the end. And it's basically like just a very fine hook that is intended to grab maybe two or three hairs at a time. Like it's just small enough to grab that many. You can get those on our website as well. And wig caps are great to have because they will A, keep your wig clean, and then they'll also add more friction and keep your hair contained under the wig. I didn't bring all of my supplies because I couldn't bring it all in my luggage, but Typically, there's two types of wig caps. There's a nylon kind that kind of looks like pantyhose, you know, has that sort of fabric is what it, you know, that it's made out of. And I find those really good if you have like super short hair, but they are usually tighter, so I don't like them because I'm prone to headaches. There's another kind that's basically a net, like a fishnet style cap, and those ones are great because they are more comfortable and they can also contain longer and thicker hair as well. But yeah, I always wear a wig cap because, you know, wigs are not human hair, so they don't produce the oils that human hair does. But if you want to keep them pretty clean longer, then you want to wear a wig cap just to kind of contain all your own oils and things like that. Okay, so getting into heat-resistant wigs. So back in my day, we didn't have heat-resistant wigs. We had to use hot water and things like that to straighten wigs, and because otherwise, if you tried to use heat styling tools, it would either stretch the fibers out just slightly, or it would cause it to frizz or melt. Even if you could use an iron on a low heat setting, but that's like, you know, you just have to still have to be really careful with it. But now there's a lot of heat resistant fibers available out there. The classic fibers we carry is up to 420 degrees heat resistant, and to give you any idea of what that's like, I have a Qi flat iron, which are like those expensive $100 flat irons that get really hot. It goes to 410, so that won't melt my classic wigs, but it could melt the silky wigs because the silky wigs have a lower heat point. So if you have an iron, just kind of like check out the settings to see if it goes too hot. If it goes too hot, just make sure you work in a lower setting. I usually recommend working in the 250 to 350 degrees range, even if it's that 420 degrees, because it's just going to make the fibers more durable longer. Just, you know, like flat irons, if you don't have like a heat setting knob on it, just test it out on a small piece, like on the underside, just to make sure that it's not going to melt your wig. Because I know that there's like those true ones that you can get at Walmart or things like that, that usually they're going to be a lower heat setting, but I've had irons before that like they broke and then the heat just wouldn't stop getting higher and higher and higher. So just be careful if you have one of those kinds of weird flat irons. Okay, so I actually brought a piece of weft. Who said that? I'm getting over being sick, so I'm sorry if my voice goes out. There should be a piece of hair in there in the flat iron if you want to plug it in.
There should be one beneath the table.
Right there. I don't see air. Is that a wig?
Oh, yeah, it's in
there. Like, do you want a straight iron and cheetah?
Let's do it for science.
Curl your cheetah.
There you go.
Alright.
Is this my color, do you think?
Alright. So, okay, this is some of the classic fibers that I just brought, and typically, if any of you guys are familiar with thermoplastics, like Warbla and things like that, or even working with craft foam, you know how if you heat it up to shape it into a curve, you have to wait for it to cool down before it'll actually hold that curve. Well, it's going to be the same way with synthetic wigs, because they're basically a thermoplastic. So, if you try to use your curling iron on it, you know, you curl it up, and then you let it go, it's not going to stay. It's going to suddenly fall flat again. So you have to kind of treat it the same way. And usually my favorite method is that I'll wear a glove, and then I'll heat up the hair with a flat iron, and I'll wrap it around my fingers, and then I hold it for a little bit, just long enough for it to cool down just a bit, and then I'll release it, and I'll get that curl. So I'm going to have him hold this.
Can you use curlers?
Like, yeah, you can.
Yeah,
I actually did that too, but it's just, I found it faster to just wrap it around my fingers. So,
thank you. Yeah, like, the rollers have little teeth in them to hold the hair in place, which is good if you're doing, like, a big project. But
well, it depends on the type of roller. Because, yeah. The foam rollers have a smoother surface. There's the kind that have kind of a mesh to it, but doesn't have that Velcro-ness to it. I don't like the Velcro ones because they get caught and then it's just a mess trying to get it undone. But the ones that are just kind of like a more mesh are better. Oh, I'm sorry. It's hard for me to multitask.
I'm going to seat it up. And the different sizes of roller you use, or you can use other things. Like sometimes I'll wrap around a large spool of thread if I want a more wavy look instead of a ringlet. So try different kinds of like sizes of things to see what you're trying to get. And I just need a little more time. If you have a cool shot setting on your hairdryer, you can blast it with that to kind of speed up the process. Yeah, it's probably not. It's not completely cool yet, but. Ta-da! Hold that cool. Yay! And if I had held it longer, it probably would stay a little tighter. But since I released it while it was still a little warm, it kind of was a little looser. So try different things and see what happens.
And you can straighten it back out super easy afterwards.
Oh yeah. So.
Could you also use a dowel rod instead of your fingers?
Mm-hmm. I've done that before too. Anything you can get your hands on. Straight again. So, and that's another thing too, and I'll talk, I guess, more about it when we're talking about untangling and care, but if your wig gets frizzy at the bottom and it's a heat-resistant wig, and it's a straight wig, you can smooth that frizz out with a flat iron.
Yeah, you don't have to trim it out or pull it out. Or
it's trickier with curly wigs, though, because you'll have to like recurl it afterwards. But,
I'm talking, but thank you.
So there's that. Also, like, if you're wanting a specific kind of effect, another popular method for curling wigs is that you can braid it and then dunk it in like boiling water, followed by like some cold water, and then you take the braids out and you've got like this really cool wavy look to it. Depending on how thick the braids are will be how wavy or crimpy it's kind of going to look. And that's like, we have a style on our website called like the Stevie, and it's really popular with Lolita. It's just got that way, like kind of, it's like mermaid hair. I don't know, it's really just kind of that nice wave to it. And you can get that kind of effect by doing that. You can also get like more realistic kind of hairstyles. Like if you're looking at Thorin from, you know, like The Hobbit, his hair, you can, to get that kind of effect, you would want to braid the wig and do the hot water method. Right, so I went in kind of the different types of, you know, cutting tools, and I'm going to kind of go more in depth here. But so, you know, the left pair of shears there are just regular shears. That one in the middle, though, is what we call thinning shears. And it basically looks like regular shears, but it has one side that kind of looks like a comb. And what's great about those is that when you cut, it's not going to cut that entire piece of hair. It's going to, like, cut a few bits of that section, and then when you pull it, it's just going to release only so much. And those are really handy if you're trying to like cut bangs or things like that, and you want to get a nice, more feathered look to it. It's just easier to kind of get a nicer, more natural look than like. But if you have enough practice with the regular shears, you can get the same thing. It's just that they will cut differently. And then on the right there is that razor comb I was talking about, where it has a replaceable blade, so it kind of folds out. And then there's a blade, basically. You have to be careful, though, when you're using those. I've used some that the blade would get loose, and I cut myself on it. So just be super careful with those. Going back. I was going to just show you real quick. I didn't bring my shears with me, but when you're cutting hair, like if you wanted to cut this shorter, but you still wanted this nice feathered look that it has at the bottom, okay. So like you want to take your scissors and you kind of want to make a cutting motion and kind of gradually go down as you go through the hair, and that'll get that nice effect that this has. Alternatively, you could just cut straight across and then you can take your scissors and make parallel cuts to thin it out so that it's not a blunt cut and it's more thin at the bottom. And then with the razor comb, it's a matter of just kind of making a repeated cutting motion into the hair until you get that nice feathered look. But again, those will dull really fast. So you can get that same effect just by doing that cutting motion with your scissors to get through that. You don't want to do it all at once. You just want to keep gradually do bits at a time.
Yeah, she does that so that it gives a varied look like natural hair has, because natural hair grows at different rates per hair.
We also do have some cutting video tutorials on our site if you want to see some examples. And I have like one where I show if you're trying to cut like a long wig shorter and things like that. Though if you are cutting a long wig shorter, there might be, the fibers might not have this nice curl to it, and you have to like kind of give it that curl yourself to make it look more natural once you cut it. Otherwise, the hair is just going to be super choppy looking because it's just sticking straight out. All right, now we're going into the basic styling techniques, and got David Bowie here. He's my favorite. This is what people did in the 80s. If you're spiking a wig, there's a handy technique called backcombing that basically is where you take a comb and you'll take a section of hair and you'll like comb it in reverse to create this weird, it kind of makes it look tangled at the bottom, but you can kind of clean it up a bit and then it gives it just more volume. It's more easy to defy gravity that way. I did talk briefly about, you know, hairspray versus gel. So I didn't bring the, yeah, I did. Okay, so here's a hairspray. Yay, I bought it. Okay, so I'm gonna pull out this wig that's got like that pre-teased top. It's actually called the Jareth, named after David Bowie. And I'm just gonna
I'll wear it.
Thank you.
No, you don't have to wear it. Okay. I did bring a mannequin this time. I don't always bring a mannequin. So this wig already has like, you know, this nice teased texture to it. But I'm gonna make it even more crazy. You kind of want to, when you're putting your wig on a wig head, you'll notice that there's like these things, these little corner pieces that kind of are different from the rest of the hairline. And we call those ear tabs. They're basically meant to be positioned right in front of your ears, around your temples. You can kind of feel for those. And then when you put your wig on the wig head, just kind of try to straighten it so it's even. Otherwise, you'll put it on and you'll be like, it's crooked. So. And then you want to take some pins?
Sometimes you can cheat a certain style by tilting the wig slightly if you have like an asymmetrical cut or something without having to actually cut the wig that way. But that's kind of rare. It's kind of case by case basis.
So you want to get like some straight pins or T-pins like that you use for sewing to kind of put those, like you can do it around the hairline, you can put some in the top just to keep your wig from shifting around while you style it.
And always look for those pins when you pull the wig back off the wig head so that you don't poke yourself when you're putting the wig on. It's happened before.
Right, so I'm just going to take a section. I thought I turned it. No, I didn't. That's all. Okay. So, like, say I want to do a spike like this. And right now the hair is actually already teased, but it's not enough to just keep it upwards. So what I'm going to do is I want to just spray like around the base of the spike. And then you take your fine tooth comb, and then you want to tilt the teeth downwards, and then you comb backwards. Like you're just going to, it's going to make it a mess and you're going to cry. Just be like, no, it's making tangles, but it's going to look great when you're done. This would be easier also if I had a hairdryer with me, but I did not bring one. But using a hairdryer can help speed up the process. But usually if you want to comb and make it look nice, you can comb around the outside, or you can leave a section of hair along the outside that you put up afterwards so that the outside at least looks smooth. But you don't want to comb through those tangles on the inside because that's what's going to keep it up. It's like already happening here. Wow. So like say if I'm gonna make this and start doing the rest of it. Spike! Yay! Super easy.
Why did I go to the beginning? I don't know what happened there. What? Something happened. Okay, going back. So that's how you can do spikes. Adding, if your wig isn't very thick, you might consider adding more wefts or even combining two wigs together. So like this cloud wig up here, I actually styled using this same wig, a Jareth, but I added an entire pack of short wefts just in the top, and that was just the right thickness I needed to create that style. So that's actually the example right there. And that's also like how you can get like those poofy anime bangs from the 90s and 80s. So like there's a cheapy wig and you can kind of see how flat those bangs are, but just with that teasing method and a round brush, you can kind of create that nice goofy curly bang effect. All right, so wig care. Untangling, we talked briefly about starting at the bottom, working your way up. Some things you can do to keep wigs from being less like, you know, at least more manageable for you is that you could use detangling sprays or conditioner sprays and things like that. One of my favorite methods to do for wigs is to soak them in like a mixture of fabric softener and water, like a 25% solution of fabric softener to 75% water. It doesn't even need to be there for super long, maybe an hour at that, if that. And then you want to just make sure to rinse it out really well, because that is going to leave a little bit of a residue to it. And if there's too much, it's going to just kind of like, if you comb your fingers through it, it's going to like clump together weird and look, feel kind of oily. So you want to make sure that you would rinse that out really well afterwards, but then it's amazing and super soft. And it's I found it's really easy to just finger comb my wigs when I've given them that treatment. Yeah, they're less likely to tangle. If your wigs are really staticky, I heard a tip that you could use dryer sheets to kind of rub along the wigs to kind of tone that down. You also can use, I know some other popular untangling sprays include like Mane and Tail, and there's also Motions Oil Sheen and Conditioning Spray, which you can find in the ethnic hair section of most stores. Mane and Tail can be found at Sally's. They're all just different kinds of sprays that you can use to coat the wigs, and then you just let them dry for over a couple days. You might have to have the wig hanging somewhere while it dries. And then I know with like the Motions, that's what I started using before I did the fabric softener. It smells really nice, and it has a weird, like, it feels oily when you touch it, but it doesn't leave any residue on your hands. So that's a really popular spray that's easy accessible. Washing, you don't have to wash wigs as often because they're made of plastic. And if, as long as you're wearing the wig cap, then that keeps them cleaner longer. But if you're wearing a wig a lot and it's kind of starting to feel a little oily because maybe you handle it a lot, or maybe you got some makeup in it or something, typically you can just fill your sink or tub with water, like a lukewarm to cold water, and a cap full of like a gentle baby shampoo, or there are wig shampoos you can get, but you know, like Johnson's baby shampoo is fine. And you just kind of slosh that around to soak up the water, and then you just kind of gently swish your wig around in that to clean it. You can also spot clean by you can lather it a little bit, but usually you don't want to do it too much because you could potentially tangle it in the process. But you can also use baking soda for getting out a lot of hair product. Like say you style a wig, you're not happy with it, you want to start over again. Using baking soda will help get a lot of that, like the got to be stuff out. You can also use, I've used rubbing alcohol for spot cleaning, like really dark makeup spots, if the wash doesn't do it on its own. So different kinds of things. Usually you just want to pat it dry with a towel or let it hang dry. If it's a curly wig, I usually will lay it out so that the curls aren't as likely to kind of loosen while it's drying. And that's another reason why you want to use lukewarm to cold water on especially curly wigs, is because hot water would potentially relax those curls. So just something to keep in mind. When it comes to storing your wigs, I like to keep the bag that the wig comes in, and like it has that tissue and a net. So like the stuff, I usually will just keep these things. If it's a wig that I'm not styling, I'm just gonna wear it and I wanna put it away, I just will keep the stuff that it comes with just to restore it. If it is a styled wig like this one, it's good to have it on a wig head at all times. And you can just, I usually just try to keep it on a shelf that's in a cool, dry place. If it's like in a window and it gets really hot in that window, the hair might like, the spikes might deflate over time, or maybe it'll get sun bleached or things like that. So keep it somewhere cool and dry. You can also loosely drape a plastic grocery bag over it, and that'll keep dust off of it. So when traveling with wigs like this, like Carl, this is actually Carl's, I've styled it for him, but he uses this box here where he's got the wig taped to a piece of poster board, and that just kind of, when he puts it in the box, it keeps it from wobbling around. You can also, I'll mail a wig or transport it in a box, I will just tape the wig head directly to the bottom of the box to keep it from wobbling around. If you are like me though, and you typically have a lot of wigs when you go to a con, especially between myself and my husband, sometimes when I'm driving, I can use my wig rack, which is like the one pictured there. My neighbor helped me make it a long time ago. It's just a piece of wood that has some holes drilled into it with some dowel rods that are glued into those holes, and the wigs will just sit on those dowel rods because they have a hole underneath. You can make your own. You don't have to necessarily make it hold five wigs. You can make it like a two wig one or something. But those are really nice just for, like, I don't want to hold five wigs while I'm driving or have to worry about five wigs getting crushed or falling over. And you can also, if you're flying, though, typically a little more limited, depending on how much luggage space you have. When I fly, I usually use the box method. Or if you're flying, usually you can have, like, one carry-on and one personal item. And that personal item could be, like, a purse, or basically it's anything that would fit under the chair in front of you. So usually I'll just have for example, on this trip, I actually just set this wig under the chair in front of me. I had it facing, it was actually just standing upright, and I just had like my knees around the base. But like if it's too tall, you could like lay it on one side if there's like one side where it's okay for it to lay on. So different things you could do. If you have enough checked luggage space, you can always put it in like a box. Like if you could put all of your wigs in a box, as long as that box fits the checked luggage requirements, and just tape them down so they're not going to wobble over. It's a bit more risky because they treat those really roughly, whereas if it's your carry-on, at least you can hold it.
Get some packing peanuts.
Yeah, packing peanuts are good too. So all kinds of things with storage and transportation. And I think that's it. Is there any questions we have? I don't know how much time we have left.
In the back.
What if you have a character that, maybe this isn't a great question, but has partial balding or total baldness?
So we will be covering that in the advanced wig panel. But if you want to know because you can't go or something, there is different methods you can do. My favorite method that looks the best is using a bald cap and cutting a section out of the wig where that bald piece is going to be, and then you'd hear that like the edge down to your bald cap with like some spirit gum.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think the blue dress was first.
I think of Claudia from Arda,
Claudia,
which has all the ringlets that at this point needs completely re-curled.
So when it comes to untangling curly wigs, you want to work one ringlet at a time. And what I'll do is I'll start at the bottom, work your way up. It'll make it a kind of a mess, but once you're done untangling it, you take it and wrap it around your finger, and then you just slide it off, and it has that nice curl again.
Oh, it's really that easy?
Yeah. We have tutorials online.
Maybe a little bit of light.
And then in the front.
I had some questions about the glues that you mentioned earlier. Could you talk about some of those brands again?
I like the Got To Be glue, hair glue. It's the same brand as this stuff. And we do carry it on the website. Or before I started using Got To Be glued, they also have, I just use tacky glue. Actually, for the tips of spikes to keep them together. And like, you can get that stuff, like the Aliens tacky glue that comes in a gold bottle. It dries clear, so like, you can just use a few dots of that in the tip of a spike, and then it holds it pretty strong, so.
The hairspray does a lot of the work by itself. The glue's basically just for the very tip of the spikes, so that it holds it together.
And you can wash that stuff out with water and soap, so. Yes, Pat?
What about for coloring?
I will cover that in the next panel too. But there's all kinds of different dye methods. I personally have a preference to using polyester fabric dye because you can't use human hair dyes on a wig. It's not going to react to it like it would with human hair. But there are alternative methods that use different kinds of dyes and inks. It's just a matter of finding out which one works best for you, because the fabric dye method will use heat. So you have to keep in mind that you have to do some treatment to the wig afterwards.
Do you on the website have anything about your dyeing tests that you did?
Oh yeah, and I do have a couple tutorials on the website. There is one for dyeing with the fabric dyes, and I emphasize always doing swatch tests.
We carry the dyes.
there's two different types of polyester dye. One of them is by RIT. It's called RIT Dye More. I don't know if all fabric stores carry it yet, but it's a newer dye that they came out with. Like, normally they just have a dye that's meant for natural fabrics like cotton and things like that. And those colors are kind of a hit and miss. Like, sometimes they work, sometimes they don't. Sometimes they work on white, and sometimes they don't work on silver. It's really weird. So I don't trust the Rit, the regular Rit, but the Dymore synthetic dye is really good. And so is Jacquard's eye dye polyester dye. But I'll be elaborating on that if you come by to our advanced panel, because it's a very big topic. So, was there a question over on the right side?
Any other questions?
If not, I can talk more about that. It's fine.
In the back.
Can you just repeat what the stuff you use for detangling was?
I just like to use, before I even wear the wig, I'll soak it in fabric softener and water. Like 25% fabric softener, 75% water. You just have to make sure to rinse it thoroughly afterwards, because otherwise it's going to be too much residue to have that softness that you want.
Okay, thank you.
On the right and then on the left.
How long do you soak it for?
I once soaked a wig overnight because for some reason people are like, oh, you need to soak it all week. And it's just like, no, you don't. An hour is probably more than enough.
And so that fabric softener and water mixture will work on really and like beyond the point of belief tangled wigs?
You can try it. You just have to be very careful to not tangle it as too much further as you're doing it. But yeah, like if it's a straight wig and it's got a lot of frizz at the bottom because there was a lot of pull, like if you are untangling a wig and you pull really hard, it's gonna cause the fibers to stretch out, and that's what causes that frizz. So you want to be really careful, and you might try to do as much untangling as you can before you do that method. But if it has gotten frizz, you can also smooth that out with the flat iron. If it's a curly wig, though, you have to recurl it, so just some things to keep in mind. But it is easier if the wig is not as tangled before you do it. Yes?
This is more about the wig cap, but I have really long hair. So do you have any, good methods to, keep it all up?
Yeah. So like
you're halfway there already.
Yeah. So if you have two, I usually having two braids at the bottom and then wrapping them around and pinning them so that they're not all congested in one area. So it's kind of dispersed around your head. So it's kind of like a crown braid on, but you can wrap one side over and then the other one on the inside, just so that the hair is not in one spot, because otherwise it'll make kind of like a weird bulbous growth going on when you put your wig on. So,
yeah.
But
does it also help to shower beforehand?
Yeah, having wet hair helps too. I don't know if some people would get sick if it's cold or something, so just be careful, I guess, with that.
Your hair's not going to look pretty afterwards, but...
Well, you'll have this weird nice wave going on, but another method is people will do pin curls. It just is very time consuming, so most people like to do a braid or a twist. In the front, you had a question?
I was just going to ask if you style a wig that's already colored, a wig that came colored, different from just a standard wig you bought off the website.
You said styling a wig that's
right. Cool. So let's say I had a purple wig and I wanted to put a spike in it. Would I style it differently, the method, compared to as in that wig that you have up there, or would I just use the same method?
I mean, as long as, are you saying that the purple wig was dyed, or was...
It came colored purple.
It should be fine. Oh, yeah. The color shouldn't affect how it is. But if you're doing the Sharpie dye method, for example, Sharpie markers are alcohol based. So if you dyed your wig with Sharpies and then you try to use hairspray on it, it's going to cause the color to run. So, but
yeah, but the natural dye, or when a wig is dyed at a factory, it's permanently that color. It doesn't have any residue or rub off.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? All right, I don't have to be here. We got 10 more minutes, so if you guys you're too shy to ask a question in the audience, you're welcome to come up and ask me here. Grab a business card, get 5% off your next purchase if you order in the next 2 weeks. And thank you so much, and I'll hopefully see some of you guys at our next panel too.